Okay, we are live.
Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Police Off the Cuff After Hours. I'm your host. My name is Mark DeMeo. I'm with my co-host, my partner in all things law enforcement, the very handsome Bill Cannon. What's up, Bill?
Yo, what's going on? It is the first time we've done, well, one live show today, and now we're doing a show on Zoom, also live, but we did a show in the studio for the first time in, what, about 6 months?
Yeah, and I actually had the chance to bump into an old friend, a fellow comedian that I've known for years that I didn't know had also a famous brother, a famous author. And I'm happy that we have him here today. He's an acclaimed author. He's written the books. He's the author of Gangster City, The History of New York, Underworld from 1900 to 1935, Bad Seeds, Big Apple Bandits, Hollywood on the Spot. Patrick Downey, our guest, specializes in Prohibition era and Depression era crime. Guys in fedoras with machine guns. We're very happy to have you, Pat.
Well, thank you. I'm very happy to be here.
Really, I'm really, really.
I just want to shout out to us. The first time Facebook Live has worked in weeks because we were using Google Chrome. So any of you other podcasters out there using Google Chrome, get rid of fucking Google Chrome because it's not compatible with Facebook Live. Now that I said my piece, Google Chrome should be sued for this shit.
So,
there we go.
That being said,
that was my next book. You just ruined my next book, Bill. Thanks.
Retired NYPD sergeants who are angry.
Pat, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
I'm a good friend of your brother's. We're both comedians. Bill's a comedian as well, but I've been doing it a little bit longer than Bill, and I've had the pleasure of working with your brother many, many times. He's hysterical. I love him. I love his humor. And then, you know, not too long ago, I found out that he has other brothers that are also very, very talented. How many brothers and sisters are in this family? Well, how big is this?
Actually, it's just me and him. We're, the talent is between the both of us.
That's amazing. That's amazing.
Yo, Pat, you guys are from
as well.
Pat, you guys are from Hicksville?
No, we're from Detroit originally.
Oh, Detroit. Because I grew up in Levittown. I found out today that your brother was from Hicksville.
No, he lives out on Long Island now, but originally we're from Detroit.
Oh, okay.
Detroit, huh? So how did you get fascinated with New York City, a gangland era mobster? How did you get fascinated by that?
I read a book probably about close to 30 years ago now called Blood Letters and Bad Men. And then had some of the old New York gangsters in it. Then I read The Gangs of New York by Herbert Asbury.
I love that. I've only seen the movie, but I love that movie.
Yeah, it's a great book too. You should check out the book sometime. It's based on the book. That covers the criminals from around the Civil War era up until Prohibition in 1930. So I read about the guys that he wrote about, and then I just took it a step further and explored their history more, did more research, and brought out more information about the Prohibition era and before and slightly after.
There's some pretty
that resulted in my first book, Gangster City.
Pat, there's some pretty ornery mofos back then, huh?
Yeah, there's some pretty nasty people. Yeah.
But
I don't know if they're any worse than some people who are out there now. I mean, you guys see the humanity that's out there now, so I don't know if they had more colorful names, though, I think, back then. Pike or Ryan, stuff like that. Jip the Blood. I think they definitely had cooler names back
then. They definitely had great names. Like a lot of our history here in this country, sometimes gangsters come out or criminals come out of, they were people that were straight. Jesse James was, fighting for the Confederacy and right. Was so upset with, the Northern soldiers still staying there. That's when he started doing his bank robberies. Billy the Kid became, a notorious killer because they killed his mentor.
Right. He was actually, I believe, from New York City, too. Billy the Kid.
Yeah, Billy the Kid originally from New York City. So now these gangsters, I know the book Legs Diamond, I'd like to know why you're fascinated with him. But any of these gangsters that we know today, famous, were just like regular guys, but the Prohibition brought them out of it? The need to survive?
I think mostly they're all criminals to begin with, but until Prohibition came around, if you were a criminal, there's only so far you could go. and the police controlled you and the judges controlled you. But once Prohibition came and the money started rolling in, there was so much money that the gangsters started making that they started controlling the cops and the judges. They got to decide, you know, just because they had all the money. So if you wanted to become a judge and you need money, you know, go take a loan from what's his name and you'll pay him back.
Somehow. I was watching something on the Prohibition, and it was actually a woman's group, a coalition that actually started the Prohibition movement. Is that true?
Yeah, the Prohibition movement started way back in the 1800s, just by wives and whatnot who were tired of their husbands drinking away their paycheck.
Yeah, there you go.
And so, hey, we got to stop this. And it took 50 years or so, but they finally decided, yeah, if we outlaw it, that'll make it go away, which of course didn't.
Well, Pat,
that never makes it go away.
Pat, who had the most colorful gangsters during Prohibition, Chicago or New York?
Colorful. Well, they each had standouts, and like certain ones from different cities I find interesting, like Legs Diamond in New York.
Why are you so fascinated with Legs Diamond?
Because I'm fascinated with him mostly for the reason he's famous for being shot and surviving. It took 5 attempts on his life before they finally got him. And they called him the Al Capone of the East. And even though he was nowhere near Capone in, you know, size of gang or power, he got so much press. He was the most famous gangster in New York on the East Coast that he was just in the newspapers constantly. He was like a matinee movie star. And he actually got fan mail. He was famous in Europe because he got kicked out of Europe.
Why did he get kicked out of Europe? Oh, he was trying to buy drugs, right?
Right. He went over to set up a drug deal, but right before he went, he bumped a guy off, and he was having his henchmen dump the car that they killed him in Brooklyn off a pier, and they got caught, and they started, you know, just doing the work, and okay, Legs Diamond bumped this guy off. Where is he now? And oh, he just jumped on a boat. He's on his way to Europe. So they radioed to Europe, and England wouldn't let him off the boat, which he didn't really care about because he was going to Belgium to set up his drug dealers. But each country, there was somebody waiting for him at the railroad station or at the shipyard, and they tossed him on a freighter and sent him back. He had to come back with a bunch of canaries.
What kind of drugs was he looking to procure in Belgium?
Heroin.
Okay.
Oh, before his time.
He worked for Arnold Rothstein. I don't know if you ever heard of Arnold Rothstein.
Yeah, of course. I'm a big boardwalk fan.
Yeah, and he was the big, he was a drug kingpin, and Legs Diamond started working for him, and he'd gone over to Europe a number of times in the 20s to set up deals, because back then you just go to a pharmaceutical company in Europe, say we want X amount of morphine, and they didn't care, you know, oh, and if you could just send it to us, ship it to us some bowling pins or something, that'd be great. And after Rothstein was killed in 1928, Lucky Luciano, Legs Diamond, all the guys who had worked for him, you know, said, well, we know all the contacts. Let's go over and try to, you know, keep it going for us.
Didn't Rothstein fix the World Series?
Yeah, the White Sox scandal back in 1919.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's true?
As far as I know, I've never...
Hey, you're supposed to be the investigator. You're supposed to tell us.
Speaking of investigating...
That's definitely true. Heard it here.
You know, Bill and I are both investigators. I was a detective for 13 years. Bill was a sergeant in the homicide squad. How much investigation goes into writing a book about Legs Diamond, Gangster City?
How much? Well, it can be difficult because, you know, unlike someone like Thomas Jefferson or a general in World War II, these guys didn't keep diaries. They didn't write long flowery letters to each other telling them what exactly was on their mind. They kept to themselves, you know. If they killed somebody, they didn't brag about it.
Uh-huh.
So depending on who you're researching, all you really have are newspapers, which can have some good information. And then you have to do I spent a lot of time in lower Manhattan looking at court records, court documents.
Oh, that's interesting.
Trial records and stuff like that.
How do you find that kind of stuff? What do you have to do to get that?
In the municipal archives in downtown New York, you can, if they were tried there, they have all the trials by number, and you have to find out the number of the trial. And if the transcripts still survive, then they can get them for you.
Is it on slides?
The numbers are on slides, but you can actually get files with actual paper, the lawyers wrote on and stuff like that. You can get the actual physical files.
Wow.
So you put a request in there, and then how long does it take for you to actually get that information?
Oh, I don't know.
Because it's New York City. We know how slow that works. So two or three years later, while you're writing your book, what happened?
it's a couple of weeks. But it's amazing what's in there. I found some Murder, Inc. files, and they had like pieces of a car that a body was found in, like the ignition for some reason. Here's the ignition from a 1940 Ford. And just a piece of rope or something like that. And the fact that this sort of evidence still exists and sitting in a box.
Do you get to read police reports from back then?
If they still exist, yeah.
I wonder, well, how long are the if you've read one on murder, because, you know, usually there was a time on our job when there was so many homicides in New York City that a homicide, unless there was a witness or something obvious there, the case could be like two or three pages long, you know, our folder. Yeah. And then nowadays, you got a homicide. You're walking in with boxes full, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. I've gotten empty folders. I've gotten folders with three sheets of paper. And then, I've got a box with the ignition from a 1940 Ford. So it all depends on the murder, why they saved it. I don't know. Or maybe over the years, people have picked away at it. So who knows? 40 years from now, 50 years from now, someone could be writing a book and they'll be going over your paperwork from one of your cases.
Pat, you ever find any family members of a victim or one of these gangsters that was willing to talk with you and provide you with inside information?
Most of the guys I talk to have been dead for like 80, 90 years. What I get are a lot of family members who, there's this uncle we were never allowed to talk about.
Right.
And his name was, you know, whatever, Bill Lovett. Oh yeah, I know that guy. And you know, I'll help him out, shoot him some newspaper articles or help him where I can.
But then that becomes more like legend than fact, right?
Yeah, I mean, whatever the newspaper said, sometimes I can say, hey, this is what the newspaper said. And they might say, oh, well, no, or actually, this is a little more what happened, you know, something like that.
Right.
Your brother said that you had a telegraphic memory for stuff like this ever since you were a kid. What got you fascinated with this era in crime?
I don't know. I've been asked this a lot and I never come up with an answer for it. I just remember ever since I was a little kid, like 4 or 5, just watching the old black and white films and just the guys with the fedoras hanging off the cars, you know, da-da-da-da-da, with the machine guns, the old James Cagney type things. It just always, for whatever reason, interests me. And then when I started reading about it, oh, stuff like this really happened. You know,
which one was your favorite movie?
Based on real people, so even better.
Which Gangland movie was your favorite movie from, Angels with Dirty Faces, Scarface? Which one was your favorite one?
From when I was a little kid.
White Heat.
I think one of the top is Dillinger with Warren Oates, because it was in color and it had the old cars. So that kind of hit me big. But I would say Angels with Dirty Faces had a good shootout in it. That one. Public Enemy with James Cagney was good. All the old ones are good. Paul Muni and Scarface, they're all fun. They're just
Top of the world, Ma.
Top of the world, Ma.
I love that. The best. All of those gangsters always had mother complexes, you know? Just like Elvis, you know, they were like, Ma, I'm here, Ma.
You know, I was watching something on James Cagney and where he got the, when he pushes his pants up like that. I forget what the reason for that was, but that was a big character trait, the way he used to pull up his pants like that using the
He got it from some guy on, he grew up in New York City and there used to be some character in his neighborhood who would, you know, on the corner, you know, who knows what he was doing there, but it just, you know, so he picked it up from him. It was, you know, turn of the century gangster in James Cagney's neighborhood that he saw, you know, and he picked up pieces like George Raft flicking his dollar in Scarface. He got that. George Raft used to hang out with Oney Madden, a lot of the New York gangsters at the time. So
Cagney grew up in Yorkville, you know, which is known now as the Upper East Side, right?
I'm sorry, I missed that.
I said James Cagney grew up in Yorkville, which is now known as the Upper East Side.
Yeah, around like 90th Street,
91st. Yeah, yeah. That is housing projects over there, Brian. The most sought after housing projects in the city on First Avenue in the 90s. You know,
I was watching something on bootlegging and the Prohibition and how as soon when the Prohibition came out, like anything else, it doesn't happen overnight. So right. By the time it was going through the courts and there was a chance that it was going to pass, everything was already in place as far as the gangsters that already bought all the breweries, they were ready to go. So they were just waiting for Prohibition to actually happen so this way they can start making some real money.
Yep. They, I think a lot of the early stuff was, there was a lot of the legitimate distillers and brewers had warehouses full of stuff because they weren't quite sure, is it going to last? You know, how long will it last? And then gangsters would be able to break in. Sometimes they probably did break in, but other times it might have been, the distillers themselves saying, unload it and give us our cut. And then, as you said, by like 22, 23, they started buying up the breweries and bringing stuff, a lot of stuff in from Canada, bringing stuff up from Cuba. So yeah,
it's interesting that a law turned all these guys from, like you mentioned earlier, just regular criminals to millionaires literally overnight.
Pretty much.
And we're talking about millionaires at the time where $1 million was a billion right now because they always talk about John F. Kennedy's dad was a bootlegger and that's how he had all the connections with the mob and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So that's so interesting that this country did that turned all these gangsters into millionaires overnight.
Yeah, and I think we'll never know how big it was, but I'm sure there's a lot of corporations out there now and businesses out there now that got their start because Grandpa, who was originally, dragging his knuckles along the Lower East Side, became, like you said, a millionaire. All right. From 1920 to 1933, was able to amass $400,000, $500,000, and now they own a string of grocery stores or something,
Well, Pat, what's interesting is that the routes that they use, the bootleggers used, are used by the drug traffickers. Some of the same routes that were used, to the Caribbean and all this other stuff. It's the same ones, to Mexico. Now, of course, all the different cartels in Mexico, but the bootleggers laid the groundwork for them.
Yeah, they set up the blueprints and they just
set up the blueprint.
It worked for them. Yeah, it's going to work, right?
Hey, the funny thing is, I was thinking about the COVID and all these businesses that shut down, including obviously the bars and the nightclubs. Mm. And I was thinking to myself, how long is it before these people open up through the back door? You got to say a password to get in. And then it dawned on me the difference between this and the Prohibition was. The COVID is a situation where if you go out and you get infected, you could bring it home to your family. So there's a virus in the air that can kill you. Mm-hmm. And that's why these people are staying shut because to me, otherwise they would open up. But that's the reason why you don't want to really break that law. Where in Prohibition time, it was just the alcohol that was illegal. So you weren't really hurting anybody except yourself, literally.
Right. And there's some cases of people getting bad alcohol, wood alcohol, and dying. That definitely happened.
So, oh, really?
Yeah, if you got, if you didn't know your bootlegger, then you're taking the chance because, who knew what you were getting? Just like I'm sure out on if you're into drugs and you don't know what you're getting, right? If you don't know the guy or who knows what they're giving you. Same thing back then. If somebody could make a quick couple of bucks selling poison, they're going to do it.
How did Legs Diamond get his name?
That's up for debate. Some people say he got it because he ran out on his friends. Legs, runs out on his friends. Some say because he's a good dancer. Some say he got it because he's real fast. He could snatch something off of a cart and be down the street before they could catch him. But the closest thing I saw that may be the truth and not as exciting as the other ones was the cops on the Lower East Side used to call his brother because he had a brother who was a gangster too, Eddie. And they used to call him Eddie Leggy. And one of the times that Legs got shot, he was in the hospital. you know, the news guys are talking to the cops what happened, and one of them said leggy, and they turned it to legs, and you know, from there on out he was legs, just because it had such a legs diamond, has, you know, what a ring. It just has a good ring to it. So a lot of the guys, especially around Prohibition time, got nicknames from the press. They would come up, because if you look at his early legs diamond stuff, they call him Bad John or the Cobra or King Cobra, something like that. Nothing stuck, and then legs that just clicked. It's, you know, just marquee value right there. Legs diamond.
Like Bugsy Siegel. I just watched that recently. You know, it's a pretty nice movie, man. It's beautifully shot. I think Warren Beatty did a good job with that. And yeah, he definitely brought out the you know, you wouldn't think of him as being that sinister, but it was done well. Bugsy was originally from New York as well, wasn't he?
Yep, Brownsville, Brooklyn, I think he came from. And then he was on the Lower East Side with Meyer Lansky and the guys. The Bug and Meyer Mob is what they were called.
What are they called?
The Bug and Meyer Mob.
Oh, the Bug and Meyer Mob. Yeah. And it's different, the ethnicities too, because you had Jewish guys.
Mm-hmm.
You had Italians. You had the Irish.
Yeah, the Irish on the West Side, some Irish in Brooklyn, yep.
Yeah, the Westies, they called them on the Irish guys, right?
No, that was more like 60s and 70s, the Westies. Oh, okay. They came later.
That was before that.
Yeah.
Let me ask you something. Back in the Prohibition days, was this, the gangsters, were they mostly the Italian mafia or no?
No, the mafia is definitely there in the Italian neighborhoods, but pretty much the whole west side of Manhattan was Irish. So you had like Oney Madden was the top Irish guy, but... And there's other guys that just you don't hear their names anymore just because they didn't have they didn't get gunned down in a a bloody way. So there's some gangsters you hear more than others. But you had a lot of Irish, Italian, Jewish, obviously. Chinatown actually had a lot of murders. You had the Tong Wars going on. And Chinatown, as you know, is, you know, just what, four streets, Doyers and a few other streets.
Yeah.
You know. On square footage, they had probably more murders than anyone.
Hey, how did these guys live? Like, if you could compare it to today, as far as money making, you know, you always see in the movies, they're living in out of hotels. Mm-hmm. You know, Al Capone is coming out. He's got his own thing. Like Legs Diamond, for example, or people, mobsters from New York. How much money did they actually have?
Probably varied day to day. But as for living in hotels, yes. A lot of them, that Legs Diamond had a couple of suites at a couple of different hotels throughout the city that, you know, well, tonight I'll sleep at the Edison Hotel or I'll sleep at this hotel. And he also had a house up in the Catskills. But by the last year of his life, all his money was gone and he was in a cheap boarding house, and that's where they killed him.
Yeah, like you said, they had a few attempts on his life. And why would he wind up in the boarding house?
He had no money. He had a couple of trials, and as I said, he was so famous that he really couldn't operate just because the press was always around him and or the police. And when you got that much attention, you can't operate like you used to. And he had a couple of trials too, which are expensive with lawyers and whatnot. And just as money was dwindling, and by his last trial, he was in like a $12 a week boarding house with his wife. Sure.
What was your most spectacular homicide of the Prohibition era? Well, one that you find the most interesting?
Vincent Cole. That's a pretty interesting one. Mad Dog Cole. He got in a phone booth in a drugstore, supposedly talking to Oney Madden, trying to shake him down for like 25 grand, threatened to kidnap his brother-in-law. But he was set up probably by someone in his own gang at about 12 o'clock midnight. He left his hotel with one of his henchmen. They enter a drugstore. His henchman takes a seat at the bar. Cole goes into a phone booth, starts talking. About 5-10 minutes later, a big sedan pulls up. A couple of guys jump out, guard the door. Another one walks in, pulls a Tommy gun out of his coat, tells everybody to be cool, walks to the end of the bar, lines up with Cole in the telephone booth, and lets him have it. That's probably one of the most colorful ones.
You know something? Those Tommy guns were so cool looking, but they made them, I guess, from after that era, it's a federal offense just to possess one of those. Yep. But now guns that are like that, like Mac-10s and, mm-hmm. You know, Uzi, you don't see an Uzi. An Uzi is actually, an Israeli-made weapon that's very expensive. So you don't see them on the street. Well, you'll see those machine pistols like MAC-10s. You know? Mm-hmm.
There's they did a gun buyback in Jersey about 10 years ago in Trenton or Camden or something like that. And they're showing what a success it was. And they had this big table of guns and there's a Tommy gun on it. And I was just like, oh, who turned that in for $100?
You know what that's probably worth?
It's got to be like 12 grand or something.
To a gun collector, that's probably worth a fortune, you know?
I know, yeah. Someone took that home. They didn't just toss that in the scrap heap with the rest of it.
We don't want this out there.
I don't think that's in the evidence room.
No, that's in someone's den right now.
Yeah. It's a collector's item. It's been sold on the internet, the black market, like 10 times already.
Yeah, I'd love to have one. That'd be great.
Did you ever hold one in your hand?
No. Just the BB gun one you get at the carnival where you got to shoot out the star. That's the closest I've ever come. But apparently, I think my brother was telling me there's a gun range in Florida where you can shoot one.
Really?
Yeah. So I want a road trip down to Florida just to do that.
Usually those guns aren't very accurate, and I don't know back then, but now they shoot 9mm or 45 caliber. So you can just imagine a machine pistol that's shooting 45 caliber, but the bullets are spraying all over the place because they're inaccurate, but that's a lot of firepower, you know?
And someone Hunter actually had one of those, there was a gunsmith in the Midwest who could tinker with guns, and they would take a 45 and put he'd be able to put whatever, a 15 round clipper and fire a 45 pistol like a machine gun.
Right, yeah, they could still do that, yeah.
Hey, when you're getting really into your investigation, you're writing these books, do you almost feel like you're living in that time, or do you have to like put yourself there mentally for that period? You know, because that to me that's fascinating, because you start thinking about the clothes,
yeah,
you start thinking about the music,
yep.
You know, and
I try to do everything, all research like that. One of the funnest things to do is to actually go to the neighborhood. A lot of it's been torn down, but there's still, some out there. I used to do a walking tour in the East Village, and to actually see the buildings and so-and-so got killed here, so-and-so lived here, and just helps bring it to life, bring it off the page.
I do that with my kids sometimes. I ride around Manhattan. I see over there, this guy got whacked over there. I tell them about homicides that I worked on. They're like, oh, shit,
man. Yeah, my wife still jokes about that. When we started dating, we'd be walking somewhere in Manhattan. I'd be like, oh, hey. some guy got rubbed out here in 1923. Oh,
what happened with the walking tour? That sounds so interesting.
I did it a handful of times, and that was it. And
you didn't sell it off to somebody?
New Jersey. What's that?
You didn't sell it off to somebody? You could actually instruct a group of people, and they'd go out there and do it for you. Huh. And you can make money on all of them.
Yeah, we thought about doing something like that, but I thought the insurance was going to be outrageous.
No, we know a comic named Tom. We know a comic named Tom Delgado that's a tour guide, and he did some of that stuff. Showing people where guys got, of course, Umberto's Clam House, but it moved though. It's not there anymore.
It's not the same one. I went in the original one, and some old guy who worked there. Yes, sir. Can I help you? And I just said, "Did you work here when Joey Gallo got shot?" His eyes get big. He's like, I don't know what you're talking about, sir. I wasn't even alive then. Okay, you were here.
Well, I took him up to Rayo's. I actually worked that murder. Some guy, a wise guy at the bar, was screaming at this woman who was singing. And this old-time bookie said, hey, buddy, give the lady a chance. Show some respect. And he said something really disgusting to this poor old man. And the old man pulled out a gun and shot him dead at the bar.
Well, they were both connected.
Yeah, well, but the guy who was killed was a made guy.
I think they were both in the.
Oh, Louis Lump. No, his name was Louis Barone. He was an associate. He wasn't made. He was like a bookie, but he got 15 to life, and he died in prison. By natural causes, no one whacked him. So they say you kill a made guy, you're gonna whack. He lived till
You know, what's funny is that when they asked him, the detectives asked him, why were you carrying a gun? He goes, well, we went to level 3, what was it?
The orange alert, terrorist alert.
So he took his gun out with him that night.
Hey, you never know.
Fight off some Al-Qaeda with this 38.
Yeah, always have some good answers. Some, I forget what gangster was, but they caught him with a 45 or something like that. Yeah, I was out hunting. 45, okay.
I mean, it's such a romantic period when you think about speakeasies, you think about New York City, having to give that password at the door once you get in. You know, they try to recreate it in New York City. I used to do a comedy club down in the on the Lower East Side, and right across the street was the Beauty Bar. And if you went into the Beauty Bar, it would look like a, you know, like you went to get your hair done then. But then you'd walk into a bar, you'd keep walking to the back. They, you know, you go through the door, and all of a sudden it was a nightclub, you know, and the music was pumping in there. And so that gave me like a little bit of a feeling of, there was also this place, Milk and Honey, we had a call up in beforehand. I used to have a friend that was, she was on a soap opera. So she got us in there. And you got to sit at the table with strangers, and you can't communicate with other tables or rap to girls. And there was a whole thing. But it got me thinking about what it was like to go to, like, you know, speakeasies back then.
Yeah, I would love, if I had a time machine, every night I'd be back in New York, you know. Go out to hit one of the big movie houses, because I love all the Palace Theaters, those just giant theaters. I love those too. So I'd like to go to see a movie, speakeasy, and then go see some guy get rubbed out, you know. I know where to go and what time he's going to be there. Just stand that, across that the street. Here he comes.
That you're even using the old-time language, rubbed out. Now they say whacked, right? Back then it was rubbed out. Now it's whacked.
Rubbed, you know, out, that, bumped off, one-way ride.
Yeah.
That would be a great tour, actually. If you could put all those three events in one night and acted it out. But in the same venue, you just go in one place, you're in a bar, you go in the next door, you're this, and then all of a sudden in the last room, after you just had a great time the whole night, somebody gets whacked in that last room, or rubbed out. I think that would be a great night out.
Especially if you don't know who's going to get whacked.
I've done dinner theater, man. It can be done. It's, you know.
That'd be fun.
In a horrible way.
Drinks, and all of a sudden a couple guys walk in. Everybody be quiet.
I used to play Salmonella in The Godfather Michigan Wedding.
Salmonella.
That was my name, Salmonella. I used to go up to tables and go, "Hey, what's up, everybody? Hey, I'm Salmonella."
Pat, you know what is really interesting? I'd love to hear about is the crimes against the early movie stars. You got to tell us some of those.
A lot of the big crimes at the time was extortion and threats of kidnapping. This is like sort of. Kidnapping was pretty big at the time, even with gangsters. A lot of gangsters would kidnap other gangsters because you didn't have to worry about them calling the cops.
Right.
You had to worry about them killing you, but you didn't have to worry about going to jail. But a lot of with the movie stars, you know, they'd show up at the studio, then they would come with their mail and, you know, "Hey, I saw your movie. I'm a big fan. And by the way, if you don't give me $5,000, I'm going to kidnap your daughter." And, you know, just things like that. Marlena Dietrich, Ginger Rogers, a lot of the stars would, Bing Crosby, pretty much everybody. They would, at one point, they were getting letters, and the FBI was always in Hollywood having to chase these guys down. So a lot of people, you know, "Oh, it'd be great to be a movie star," which it would be. I mean, especially during the Depression, they're living like kings, which probably was played a lot of part into it, especially the fan magazine saying, you know, "John Barrymore now makes $15,000 a week."
Right. So
gangsters are going to be like, "Oh, well. Oh,
shit, we should take it." Well, you ever see the scene in The Sopranos where Lauren Bacall plays? She went to this premiere of a movie, and they give him these goodie bags, and she's walking out, and they rob her. They rob her on the street. That's like petty anti shit, but that's these wise guys. They do stuff like that, too.
In L.A. was... once word got out how much money was there with the studios, the mob came out and started infiltrating the unions in the studios. And a lot of the actresses, they're wearing $50,000 worth of jewelry. And $50,000, like you said, back then, it's like $500,000 now, close to $1 million. And there's stories about just coming to their door, "Ding dong, Western Union. Oh, okay, let me sign for it." And they just push their way in, tie them up, take all their stuff. Zeppo Marx, the Marx Brothers, he got robbed twice. One time he was having a little dinner party and these bandits came to the door, barged in, tied everybody up, wired their hands behind their backs, took them upstairs. "You know, where's your jewelry? You know, you got more than that. Come on, where are you hiding the good stuff?" So locked in his wife in the closet.
Those are usually inside jobs too. Someone usually points the bad guys to the location.
Yeah, it could be like one of their servants or something. And yeah,
they still do it today.
They were getting fleeced by everybody. Grocers, you know, hey, why is my bill $200?
Yeah, for a slice of pizza.
We hope you don't notice.
That's interesting. With the insight, I just saw how Kim Kardashian, when she got robbed in Paris, that was a 2-year operation.
They were planning it for 2 years?
Yeah. Yeah. And they almost did it the first time, except for Kanye was there that time. So they backed off. And then this time he didn't go with her. And they went through with it. But there was over 20 people involved with that. It wasn't just and, you know, everything is like you mentioned newspapers. And how they would find out how much money these people had or where they frequented through a newspaper. Now with social media, she's posting that ring that she got from Kanye, which was, I don't know, $28 million or some shit like that.
But,
you know, they're so our newspapers back then were these people's social media now. You know what I'm saying?
If you're saying $28 million, there's people who are going to be up for that challenge. Like you said, even if it takes 2 years and 20 people, that's a million a piece. You know, you're just asking.
There was this stick up of a jewelry store in Paris, and they were refusing to open the safe, and the guys were starting to get violent. So finally, the woman manager says, all right, I'll open the safe. She opens the safe, and they just clean out the safe. And before the guy left, he kissed her on the cheek. Big mistake. They swabbed the cheek and got his DNA and ID'd the guy.
Oh, nice. I didn't think that went through.
That was great.
I'll be the kissing bandit.
Yeah,
be
no more kissing bandits, you know.
Yeah.
They can process the saliva.
And that's robberies. I mean, during the 20s, you know, Prohibition, you hear a lot about that, obviously, but it was robberies in New York City at the time that really made the press even more than the bootlegging gangsters, because at that time in New York City, you had factories, every big business, large business. And at the time, they all had to produce a payroll, and they would pay cash. This was before the direct deposit, obviously, and pay checks. They would pay, you would dole out money in envelopes. And so these places are just getting picked off on a daily basis. A shoe factory, you know, with a $20,000 payroll. And then you'd have one guy from the bank, or probably from the shoe factory, who would go pick it up and bring it back. And a lot of inside jobs, like you mentioned, Bill. You know, someone who maybe got fired and they're mad, and, you know, hey, you want a quick 12 grand every Thursday? He picks it up at the bank at Fifth Avenue and 57th Street, and he has to walk 2 blocks. So they just, you got one or two guys walking back from the bank, and then two big sedans pull up and guys jump out with shotguns. It's all and then
give it up
on a daily basis. Boom, 2-3 a day.
Wow.
And jewelry stores too, like you mentioned, jewelry stores always getting hit. And a lot of the jewelers, though, always fought back. A lot of them had guns, so there'd be gunfights.
Wow. Yeah, I'm sure in the Diamond District, even today,
the Hasids
have guns, you know.
The Hasids, they were fighting back, the Hasids.
That's right.
They were still back then. They were still there. Mm-hmm. 1947, you go to 47th Street and Fifth Avenue, they're right there, the Hasids. holding it down. You can't get on that block. If you're on that block, you're not. Do you remember when they, a couple of years ago, they tried to rob it a couple of times, do a robbery on that block?
47th Street?
Yeah, grab diamonds out of the Diamond District. It's not easy to get out of there.
No.
Well, there's so much traffic during the day. You know what they were doing for a while? I was in street crime in the 1988, and the yaks, they called them, Yemenis, Armenians, Croatians, and Serbs. They would get vans and a Grand Fury with a red light, and they would drive the van right through the window of Tiffany's and just clean out Tiffany's. And when if anyone was saying, hey, what's going on? They had the light with a police car, and they said, we got it taken care of. Don't worry about it. And then they take the van and they drive right over to 59th Street Bridge. They hit so many locations, and they knew police procedure because they would call at 1013, like 20 or 30 blocks away. So every cop, miles around was at the 13, you know.
Uh-huh.
It was pretty ingenious. They made a lot of money, those guys. But eventually they caught all of them.
Do they all get caught eventually? What's the success rate, in your opinion?
And but for that, well, if it's organized,
just crime, anything. I mean, you know, the old adage, crime doesn't pay. Does it or doesn't it?
No, eventually they all get caught.
They all get caught.
Maybe real smart. There's not that many real smart criminals. If they were smart, they wouldn't be criminals, you know?
You know, the funny part about it is, too, also, especially now in today's mafia, if you're out there and you're doing these type of robberies, like Bill mentioned, at some point, you're going to get a visit. I'd be like, hey, you're doing really good out there. But, you know, where's the money? you got to call some up. And you might be, it doesn't matter if you're Italian.
Mm-hmm.
They'll give you a pat on the back. You're doing a great job out there, but
this is my area, right? I get it.
Then they slip you a piece of paper on how much they want out of it, and you better make the nut. Otherwise, they're going to the feds. They give your name right up.
Really? That's what you're going to end that with. You end up, you know, in the river or something, but they just turn you over to the feds.
Yeah. Why? What are we going to get our hands dirty?
Yeah.
You know that. I mean, that's the reality of it. They're going to offer you a price. If you don't match it. If you're not with a crew connected, you're just out there, you know, starting your own thing. You're gonna have to buck up.
Yeah,
they know who's doing what.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the streets. Listen, if you're here in New York City and if you're involved in that life, you're gonna know who's who, where's where, who's doing what. Right. You got to get rid of the stuff. You know what I'm saying?
Uh-huh. That's like some of the old cities during that time, the crime wave of the 20s and 30s, like St. Paul was a crooked town. If you're like John Dillinger or a mob guy who needed to hide out, you were allowed to go to St. Paul as long as you paid and didn't cause any trouble while you were there.
You mean like Seattle?
No, Minneapolis.
Where it is now?
Yeah, like Seattle. You mean like Portland?
And they weren't allowed to light fires back then.
Yeah, but you know what, though? In a funny way, it is kind of sort of the same in a places where lawlessness is actually tolerated.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's how the FBI became as powerful as they are, because they would be on the trail of a Dillinger or someone like that. They'd trace him to St. Paul. But at that time, 32, 33, they weren't allowed to make arrest and they weren't allowed to carry guns. So they'd have to go to the local police and say, we know Dillinger's at this apartment house. So we have to go, you know, we'll bust him in the morning. But the cops are crooked. They're on, you know, Dillinger's paying to be there. So he gets a call. We're going to be there tomorrow morning at 7 a.m. So the next morning, cops and FBI rush in and cricket.
Yeah. It's exactly the way it is now. I mean, what's the difference between that and then bail reform? What's the difference? They put you in, they arrested you for a crime, and next thing you know, they're just letting you out. This is
revolving door.
You go do it again.
Just cut out the middleman and not arrest you.
Yeah.
You catch the same fish 3-4 times. Right?
That just must be infuriating.
You know what
helps ease the pain? When you get your paycheck and there's, 18 hours of overtime on there. Who gives a fuck? You know what? Is he out, really? We'll go get him again. And I'll rock the clock again. He wasn't a bad. He smelled okay. Nothing better than locking up somebody who's making money in the street because they smell okay. They dress good. The worst thing you want to do is spend 14 hours with somebody who smells like shit. You know what I'm saying? Give me a fucking criminal, a regular gangster any day. Plus, they have respect. You feed them. They tell you good stories. It's not a bad day.
Sounds good.
I'm sure it was the same way back then, too.
Yeah.
I remember when a prisoner would have his own money, he'd say, can I get a couple of slices of pizza? I said, yeah, sure. Give me your money. I'd buy it from him. Officer, buy yourself a couple of slices, too. I was like, no, thanks. It's all right.
Really? It's on me. Come on. Yeah,
I don't need a robber to buy me pizza.
Yeah, there's tales of that too, like Al Capone or whatever. You got to go to jail. Okay, well, I'm going to set up my cell with a radio and a bed and live comfortably for the year I have to be here. Okay, whatever you want, Al.
Al did some time in Sing Sing too, didn't he? He made Sing Sing famous, I think.
Al did a year in Philadelphia. It was after the St. Valentine's Day massacre. And the heat was coming down across the country because of that.
Uh-huh.
So there was a big meet with, you know, the all the gangsters from Chicago and New York and what, and they said, okay, Al, guess what? You kind of need to go away for a while. And so it was actually held in Atlantic City. And they said, okay. So they set it up. He took a train, supposed to be training back home to Chicago, pulled over in Philadelphia. Cops are waiting for him. He handed over a gun and said, oh, carrying a gun, huh? Mandatory year. So him and his bodyguard did a year in Philadelphia. And, but since he didn't really sleep on a cot and get bread and water.
Right.
It was all decked out. He had a radio and all kinds of, all the accoutrements that would make his year pass as comfortable as possible.
Was he as violent a guy as the depiction in the movie? Remember the movie where Robert De Niro played him and all the guys are around and he beat a guy to death with a baseball bat?
Yeah, it's actually three guys he killed with a baseball bat.
No kidding.
There were three of them.
Well, that's true?
Yep. That one guy was based on three guys who were double cross. He found out we're double crossing them. So he invited them to a big banquet, supposedly to celebrate something. And that's where he beat them to death with the baseball bats. They also got shot too. They found them, I think, in Indiana, the three bodies.
Wow. That's a little bit overkill, right?
What's your, which movie does it right as far as you're concerned with your historical background? And what movie do you watch? And like, they pretty much nailed it as far as I know for my dreams.
For what I like, maybe not based on anyone in actuality, I really like Miller's Crossing by the Coen brothers. Have you ever seen
That movie? Yeah, Tom Hanks.
Nope, not Tom Hanks. What's his name? Gabriel Byrne.
Yeah, he's great.
Wasn't Tom Hanks the lead in Miller's Crossing?
No, that's Road to Perdition.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
that's
yeah.
That's a fun one, too. I like that one.
Miller's Crossing. Okay, yeah, you're right. Yeah, I watched that one, too.
Miller's Crossing, I just think they got the it seemed more like 1930 to me. Just, I mean, with the clothes and the language. And some scenes are a little over the top, but it was just, I really enjoyed it. It was fun. Road to Perdition was fun.
You know, how about Dillinger? Because you know what scene I love from Dillinger? When he goes, he's looking for a place to stay, and now the mob's already like, you know, we don't want nothing to do with you. And they bring him inside where they're taking bets.
Yeah.
And he goes, you made $20,000 on your last heist. We make $20,000 over here every hour. Remember that scene where he's trying to explain to him, like, your stuff is
over. I'm losing you guys.
You froze up.
We got to keep talking.
Yeah, I love it. I could talk to him all day. I love this kind of stuff.
That happened before.
Uh-oh.
Well, before we started, but we were in the long way. How many minutes? We got 45 minutes before.
You back? I told him what to do. I told him to sign out, sign back on.
That's probably what he's doing, hopefully. But this is, this is like one
Pat,
of my...
You back?
There you go.
No, now he's signing
back. No, he's coming back. He's coming back.
Okay. Hey, look at that, man. We got a bigger frame now.
Yeah, your head looks twice the size.
Yeah, I know. Did we tell our audience what we did today? We shot a episode down in Tribeca with John Mulrooney, famous comic John Mulrooney, who was
radio personality, TV. He hosted three of the shows that I grew up watching as a teenager. My first introduction to stand-up comedy was Catch a Rising Star. It was on Fox. He was the host of that and two other shows at that time. And John's a legend in comedy. He's also a TV radio personality. And now he's fighting crime upstate somewhere, part-time.
Well, we're hoping that he joins Inside Blue 360.
Yeah.
If we ever can make money at it, because I'm sure he wants to get paid.
Everybody wants to get paid. And speaking of that, we should probably promote our Patreon now while we have a chance.
Go ahead.
If you're paying attention tonight and you enjoyed our guest, please check out our Patreon. It's Police Off the Cuff. At patreon.com. We have a couple of different tiers there where, you get content that comes to you first. It's exciting content. Bill has a show that he does on there, a true crime story. I have one-on-one, more you know, artists featured that have stuff to do with law enforcement, because that's my little thing. I'm having Bob Mladenich on. That's going to be my next guest, Bill.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, we're going to talk about the movies. We're going to talk about, you know, his acting and his books in a more like a you know, intimate way. You know, I like to have everything, you know, people that were cops, but, you know, are in our artists now, because that's what I'm into, you know? So, and who knows what happened to Pat, man?
I don't know. He may have gone.
He may have jumped ship.
MIA, you know? One of the things about our Patreon is that we give our audience, there's three tiers. The first one is called The Bucket, and that costs $7 a month. And then the second one is Polish My Rack. That's $9 a month. And the premier tier that we hope you join for $11 a month is Dipped in Butter, because everyone wants to dip him in butter, right? I think he's coming back. So if you want to join our Patreon, please join Dipped in Butter. That's the premier one. We can get paid a little bit for doing this. Pat, you back?
There he goes.
There he is. Can you hear us? He's here, but I don't hear his audio. It's connected.
Okay. He's coming. There you go.
That's one of the tough things about Zoom. You know, you can go come in and out, and you know, we can't control this shit.
Can you see me now and hear me?
Yeah, we can see you.
Okay. All right. Last I heard was Dillinger and Frank Nitti saying we're the future, right? Because we're doing 20 grand a day.
Yeah.
Yeah, that pretty much kind of showed that the end of one era and the beginning of another.
I know. Wasn't that a cool scene?
Mm-hmm. Because there was some collusion between those guys, like the desperados, as I refer to the bank robber guys, and the organized crime guys. And one of the things that brought about the downfall there was the heat from the FBI. There was something in 1933 called the Kansas City Massacre, and a guy named Vern Miller, which nobody really knows unless you're into the gangsters, was part of. And he was good friends with a guy named Louis Lepke Buchalter, who was one of the top organized crime guys in New York City. And so the FBI went to this Lepke and said, we know your friends, we're gonna make things really hot for you. Tell us where he is. But Lepke didn't wanna do that, because if they arrest him, who knows what he's gonna say. So he had him bumped off in Detroit. And so once the FBI started breathing down on all these bank robbers, they started going to the organized crime guys saying, if you hide them, we're coming after you too. So suddenly Chicago and St. Paul weren't a safe place to stay anymore. And you know, your days are numbered. Once you don't have any friends who are friends for a price, then you're done.
Well, you know what terrifies the mob today about the weapons that the FBI has, and that's RICO. You say the word RICO and every mobster wants to, you know, flee to Cuba, because that's the racketeering influence, corrupt organizations.
Yeah, it's bullshit.
They put them away forever with that. You know, they use that against the mafia cops. Ippolito and Caracappa, they used it against them. The RICO statute, yeah. And it's.
But the RICO statute was actually probably being put together during the Prohibition. That took a long time. It didn't happen overnight. Was that 80s?
Is that kind of like
80s? Yeah, I don't think it's that old. It probably came around in the 80s.
It wasn't put into effect. Right. They didn't start using it, but they started creating it for a while.
Yeah. Well,
in the 30s and 40s, it was drugs that they were afraid of, to go down for drugs, because that was sometimes, you know, with drugs and murder, obviously, because some of them, there's a handful who went to the chair for murder, but drugs was the one they didn't want to go away on, because that was the longest charge.
Yeah, like he said, he goes, what did he say? The Godfather, when he said, hey, listen, you know, whatever you do, that's your business. I have nothing to get, just as long as your business doesn't get involved in my business.
Don Corleone, you carry politicians around in your pocket like so many nickels and dimes. My son, you don't share them.
My son is actually, you know, he's a little spoiled. Sometimes he speaks out of turn.
They would not be friends much longer if I got involved with drugs, right?
My business was drugs and the gambling, even women.
Can we talk about Lucky Luciano, like Meyer Lansky, and Bugsy Siegel, and these guys that came out of New York, like they were friends since they were kids.
Yeah, well, you know, that's the myth. When they really met, how close they were. There's a book called The Last Testament of Lucky Luciano, which a lot of stuff is based on, and a lot of it's been disproved over the years. So, and it makes good Hollywood, you know, three kids growing up on the, you know, Lower East Side, and they each become big gangsters in their own right. But I suspect a lot of, you know, they met probably as adults. It's never, you know, as I said, it's not like you can go and look at these guys' letters and diaries and find out everything.
Because there's one scene in Bugsy where, you know, Ben Kingsley's playing Meyer Lansky,
mm-hmm.
and he's down in you know, he said that he would build the casino for the Flamingo for $1 million, and now they're up to $4 million, and they're all freaking out about the money,
mm-hmm.
and he's trying to tell him, he goes, you know, we've known each other since we were kids, and you know, there's only so much I can stick my neck out for you. Tell me, is this a real deal? Is this the real deal or what? And he's constantly having to speak up for Siegel, Benny Siegel, because this guy's they're going so far over budget.
Right.
And all these mobsters that invested out of New York and stuff, they're all like, how much more, you know, when is this thing done?
Right. So, I just don't know. I don't know. And I don't know if anybody knows how, were they, did they hook up when they were 8 and 9 and 12? Possibly Lansky and Siegel, maybe, but I don't think they probably hung around with Luciano till the late 20s.
Oh, wow.
And Meyer Lansky was in The Godfather. His character was called Hyman Roth.
Yeah.
Hyman Rothstein. He shortened it to Hyman Roth. He was the guy who was like, I'm living out my twilight years in Florida, right? I'm seeking asylum.
What was the movie with Robert De Niro and their kids growing up on the Lower East Side?
Once Upon a Time in America.
Yeah. Did you like that?
Yeah, that was fun. James Wood, and yeah, that was a good one. I haven't seen it in a while. I'd have to take a look to see if it holds up, but
that was one of the first movies I got when I got a VCR. Remember that, the day that you got your
VCR? No, those are from Prohibition.
You know, remember when you got your VCR and then you started going to the store, you know, yep.
Our first one was, I think, Magic with Anthony Hopkins, where he's a ventriloquist who kills people.
Oh, yeah, that's a great movie.
And yeah, I think that was just the one they had. So they had, the place we got videos from probably had 5 movies, and that was the one they had, so we got that one.
Hey, speaking of
6 times, just because you could.
What did you think of Boardwalk Empire?
I liked it. I thought it was a really good show. I thought it was a lot of fun. And I actually, some guy tried to give me a job writing on it. Said, oh, I know this guy. And they're just like, well, we'll just buy his book. So then I'm looking. I wonder if there's anything from my book. And I saw something that could have been from my book, but I can't prove it. So.
Yeah, that's interesting because, you know, we tell jokes. So, you know, embellish. Tell us a little bit, like, what was it? Because I watched the whole series. You can't get a lawsuit. The fucking thing is done already. But
I don't even remember what the scene was. I just remember watching and going, huh, that sounds familiar. my book.
Speaking of gangster movies, man, how about Johnny Dangerously? What'd you think of that, man? That was one of my favorite movies.
Joe Pesci still scares me.
No. Meyer Lansky. No. Johnny Dangerously was with Michael Keaton.
Yeah. Not Joe Pesci. Joe Piscopo. I'm sorry. That's what I was thinking of.
You farting icehole. Remember that, you farting icehole.
Hey, one of the best ones will have to be Goodfellas. That movie was great.
I killed my mother once, once. Yeah, but yeah, obviously Goodfellas is a great movie. I didn't mean to cut you off. But yeah, I shot my brother. No, I hit my brother in the head with an axe once, only once.
So Pat, does Hollywood or TV ever approach you to write a series or a show or a movie?
Never. The only approach I ever got was from some production company that makes documentaries for like the History Channel or something like that. And they, hey, basically, you do all this work and we'll put your name in the credits. How does that sound?
Yeah, yeah. No, these guys are all shadrules, man. They don't want to pay you shit.
Yeah.
We get calls from these homicide recreation shows, right? And they're like, as soon as they say, hold, stop. I want to get fucking paid.
How much?
Like, you're not paying me. Don't even stop talking to me. You know?
They're so fascinated by your career.
Yeah.
They want to sit down with you for an interview.
For hours. Pay you nothing.
Yeah, do a Zoom, and you tell them all these stories, and they're like, oh, my God, that's great. Yeah, we're going to call you. You never hear from them again. They just got 15 new the whole next season.
The whole next season,
yeah. It's just, in my case, they just want me to do their homework and, you know.
Yeah.
You know, it's
funny. Your name will be in the credits. It'll be a credit. I'm like, eh.
You know what's funny is that just the word itself, Legs Diamond, because here's the thing. It's a great title.
Mm-hmm.
Now, even if the guy wasn't the biggest mobster, he's associated with all these other people trying to make his way. Yeah. And that's where the show becomes interesting, not just because Legs Diamond, he's a mobster, he's doing all this thing. But like you said, how many assassinations attempts? Where does the name come from? You can make something up because he dated Broadway dancers with great legs.
Yeah.
Because I know he was really into the theater because I read your stuff. Mm-hmm. That just has such a great name to it, Legs Diamond. I could see it on HBO already.
Yeah, I love it. I've written some stuff. You know, you have something on standby just in case you get that phone call. And I worked with, didn't work with, but I had one guy who pushed something I had written to Stars Network. It wasn't even a gangster thing. It was actually an old Hollywood thing. And they said, okay, we're interested. If you can find a showrunner, we'll go with it, but he couldn't find a producer, so it just...
Tell us about the Hollywood thing, too, because you have another book about the Hollywood. What's that about?
Hollywood on the Spot?
Yeah.
The Crimes Against the Early Movie Stars? That's the one where...
You started telling us about that,
Bill started talking about. Yeah, it's just a number of stories about the different movie stars from the 20s and 30s and the crimes that were committed against them that you generally don't hear about, you know, when someone does a biography or... whatnot. It's like Mae West getting, you know, gun stuck in her face and losing her jewelry.
She was a tough broad, though.
Yeah. She knew all the gangsters from New York, too. She got her start in New York. She was in vaudeville and did shows. She was arrested for her lewdness, I guess you'd say, in some of her shows. But she knew Oney Madden. She knew all those guys.
So
and George Raft, who we talked about earlier, is the one who brought her out to Hollywood. Said, hey, you should come to, I'm making a movie. I think you'd be great in it. She did a bit part. Was a big hit, and you know, the rest is history, as they say.
Yeah,
and they still robbed him. Maybe they didn't know
she was inside job, Bill, as we were discussing. It was an inside job.
That's right.
Guy, he was a manager from of Tex Guinan, who was sort of like a Mae Westish woman. Hello, sucker. She, you know, tried to make it big in Hollywood, it didn't really work out, but through her, he met Mae West, and Mae West, I'll try to make this short. She was in a car accident, so he said, use my chauffeur. And so he started chauffeuring her around and hanging out with her. And she was always adorned in all this jewelry. And, you know, he was a Chicago guy, and he just said, this is too easy to be, you know, I just can't let it go. So he got a couple of local boys and said, we're going to be at her apartment at whatever it was, 8:15, because we're going to go to a wrestling match. I'll find an excuse to be out of the car for 2 minutes. And, you know, so he was out of the car. She's waiting for him. Guy comes up, sticks a gun in the car, robs her of her jewelry. And then she's like, I want to go to the police. And he's like, no, don't do that. I've dealt with these type of guys before. You're probably going to get a phone call in a couple of days, and they'll want, you know, they'll sell it back to you for, you know, 15 grand or something like that. And so sure enough, hey, they contacted me. They want 15 grand. She's like, I'm not going to do it. And so okay, they'll take 12. You know, no, I'm not going to do it. So, okay. So they went and fenced it somewhere else. And and it took a couple of years, but they finally got him. But he split to Chicago, and they couldn't have him extradited. The guy who actually did it with the gun, he went away. But the mastermind, as they say.
There are no such things as masterminds.
That's
we had a guy one time in Spanish Harlem, does a violent rape inside the housing projects, takes this girl's jewelry, goes right to the the pawn shop on 103rd Street and 3rd Avenue. And when you pawn something, you got to show photo ID. So Special Victims goes there. They just had his name and address. They just went and locked him up that same morning. What a genius, right?
Yeah, not a mastermind.
No, definitely
far from it. That's one of the lines. That's one of the lines from my act when I have a bit that I do. And one of my lines is, not a mastermind, folks. Far from it.
That's one thing a lot of people say, like when you get to Luciano or Meyer Lansky, boy, if they just went in a legitimate business, they would have been like Warren Buffett. It's like, no.
Yeah, no, I don't think so.
There's a reason they were criminals because they couldn't cut it.
Wasn't it Al Capone that said it takes just enough money, just enough brains and hard work to make a crooked million as it does a straight?
Possibly. You never heard that one.
I remember growing up and hearing that, you know. I think my father told me that when I was doing bad things. Hey, you know, son, takes just enough brains. And
but, you know, there's most gangsters have bad habits besides, you know, the degenerate gamblers.
Mm-hmm.
John Gotti was a degenerate gambler. He'd make a fortune and lose it all, you know.
Well, yeah. I think it has come to do with the way the money comes easy to you. So you get, you know, you're hoping that it comes tomorrow, too. And when it comes that easy to you.
Yeah,
easy come and go, as they say. Yeah,
I don't think too many of them die rich.
No, they really can't own anything in their name. You know.
Mm.
So did we talked about Bill asked you about the homicides, but I think you said Legs Diamond died broke. How about anybody else like die broke during that era? How did people that coming out of New York?
If they live a long life, I assume they don't die. But if they're bumped off, there's a lot of guys who are bumped off who are doing well at the time. A big one on Brooklyn was a guy named Frankie Yale. I don't know if you ever heard of him. He was actually bumped off. Capone had him knocked off. He gave Capone his start. And
So this guy from New York gave Capone his start.
Yeah, Capone's originally from Brooklyn.
And then he gave him his start and the guy Capone wind up rubbing him out?
Yeah, Capone would have some booze brought in through New York, and it was this guy Frank Yale's job to guard it and make sure it got to Chicago. And then what started happening was, hey Al, Frank's on the phone. Hey Al, sorry, hijacked. Oh, okay. A couple months later, hey Al, they got another one. He's like, uh-huh. So then Capone sent out, had a guy spying for him. He said, yeah, Yale's ripping you off. So,
wow. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I always wonder about that. Like when things are going good and I'm making money, why go after the extra money?
Because you're a criminal.
Yeah. Or it could be like Bill said, maybe he blew it all gambling and he needed to quit 25 grand. And here's these big, beautiful beer trucks with Al's beer. So sell that, get some money. Tell Al, whoops.
Well, you know, it's funny that you mentioned that because they're gangsters and they're gambling.
Mm-hmm.
So why are they paying their debts? You know, one of the things about the head of the FBI, Hoover, he loved the racetrack. And when he won, he won. And when he lost, he didn't have to pay. They didn't, you know, they didn't come to him for the money. You know what I'm saying? Like, you're a mobster. Fuck you and your fucking thing. I fucked up tonight. I'm sorry.
Yeah, but the bookies are also mobsters. So you're owing money to another guy who's half-assed.
And no one's going to take your bet.
Yeah.
If you, the worst thing you can be is a welcher. I think if you're a gangster, the worst thing you can be known as is a welcher. No one's going to want to do anything with you.
That's right. You know, it's funny. When you talked about the guy hijacking the liquor trucks, it's just like today when you get a guy that sticks up drug locations. There can't be a more dangerous profession than to hold up a drug location. That's going to end in death for the stick-up artist. And if they don't get them this week, they'll get them next week or a month later, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, you can compare that to this idiot sticking up the trucks that contain the liquor during Prohibition, you know?
Yeah, and I've read about guys like that. I'm just like, what were you thinking? Did you really think you're going to get away with it? Because there's no shortage of them. They, you know, just like you kidnapping another gangster. How far do you think you're going to get? You might get the money, but guess what? For the rest of your life, you're looking over your shoulder. And they, I mean, maybe some did get away because I haven't read about them, but there's plenty who didn't.
How about Dutch Schultz?
Oh yeah.
How many movies have been made about Dutch Schultz?
Hoodlum.
Yeah.
'90s.
Anybody come close to when you? Because I know in your research you must have come across Dutch Schultz. You know, because Legs Diamond. Yeah. Didn't absolutely. Dutch Schultz try to kill Legs Diamond?
Yeah, he's credited with saying, "Can anybody shoot this guy so he don't bounce back?" And because he used to work for Legs Diamond in the Bronx, and Legs was, you know, he had his Bronx, but he's also moving in the city working with Rothstein, and then he got shot in 1921. Times he got shot, so he was out of commission for a while. And at this time, Dutch Schultz and his partner Joey Noe decided, you know what, we don't need him. So they pretty much forced him out of the Bronx, but they're nice about it. Said, look, we're going to buy out your interest. And Diamond said, okay, meet me on 57th Street, 7 in the morning. But they knew they couldn't trust him. So Dutch Schultz and maybe a couple other guys were up in the second story windows. It was by a nightclub, famous nightclub. And Schultz's partner, Joey Noe, on the sidewalk. He's wearing a bulletproof vest because he's, you can't trust Legs Diamond. Sure enough, a Cadillac comes by. Guys open up. Bum. So Dutch Schultz and these other guys start shooting down from the second story windows. And the bullets pierce the top of the Cadillac and hit the guy in the neck, kill him. So his buddies dump him on the Lower East Side. But he had managed to hit Dutch's partner, Joey Noe, who ended up dying like 3 weeks later. So ever since then, Dutch Schultz was like, okay, Legs Diamond has to die now. And he sent out, I mentioned Legs' brother Eddie earlier. He had tuberculosis, and they sent him out to Colorado to heal. But while they were out there, they were also getting involved in rackets out there, setting up nightclubs.
Why not?
If you're there anyways.
Why waste the opportunity?
The wide open town, Jack. So they didn't know where
Legs was. Holiday is dead.
But they knew where Eddie was, so they sent out a hit team to get him. But they botched the job, and Eddie survived. But we know it was Dutch Schultz did it because one of his guys was involved, who later made the newspapers and whatnot. So
that's so fascinating.
Then a possible piece may have been made, but Dutch Schultz was definitely one of those guys whose name, when they finally got Legs Diamond, his name was at the top of, you know. He may have been the one who did it, but by that time he had so many enemies.
Well, so you're saying he outlived him. Legs Diamond outlived Dutch Schultz.
No, when Legs Diamond got killed, Dutch Schultz's name was who probably had him rubbed out.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Yeah, Dutch Schultz was a lot more powerful than Legs Diamond. He became one of the top mobsters of the city. Because now you hear about the mafia and the five families, but back then, you had a lot of the Jewish gangsters even more powerful than the Italian. You know, Dutch Schultz was huge. Lupke Buchalter, who I talked about earlier. These were just powerful guys. And like Buchalter controlled the garment industry. So he was into labor rackets and whatnot. Dutch Schultz controlled the three-digit policy lottery. And these guys, you know, and the mob had their stuff going on too. And, you know, it's not like they weren't powerful, but these guys had a bigger grasp on grip of the city and the crime that was going on. And Dutch Schultz had a good way. He dreamt up good rackets. You know, you hear about the waiters union in New York City. You know, restaurants have a waiters union. He created that. That was his, you know, hey, there's a lot of restaurants. How can I get my fingers in that? Guess what, waiters? You're now united. And it's going to cost you $5 a month to be part of this union. And then they go into a restaurant and say, shake down the owner of the restaurant saying, yo, give me $5,000. No, I'm not going to do that. Okay, we're going to come in and drop off some stink bombs, you know, in the middle of rush hour. Right. So you control the union and then you shake down the guy who owns the business. Same thing with movie theaters. There's a movie theater on every corner. They unionize the projectionists. You can't show movies without projectionists. So you get a projectionist paying you a union due, and then you go to the theater owner and say, you can yell fire during your next feature, or you can give us $1,500, you know?
Wow.
They pay, yeah.
That's interesting. It's so interesting that people sit back, you know, if you got nothing but time, you could think of all different ways to rob people who are out there working.
They're yeah. All devious shit, right?
You know, now we call them politicians.
Yeah.
Just sitting there. I saw they're giving buildings ratings now. Energy efficient ratings. And if you're going to buy a property in New York City, are you going to buy a co-op in a, especially now, are you going to buy a co-op in a building that has an A efficiency rating? Because you don't have to worry about assessments to redo the boiler, putting up scaffolding to do the windows. It's a brand new building. So who's going to buy in what building first? Otherwise, you got to comply. When you comply and you start fixing this shit, you got to start calling up all these people to come and do it. And then the city inspectors have to come in. It's a, what a fucking scam.
It's a shakedown, man. In New York City, it's become a shakedown central, you know, between the speed cameras, the red light cameras, congestion pricing, let people jump the turnstile so fucking suburban taxpayers can pay the fee for it. It's fucking ridiculous.
I talk to people about this kind of stuff, and these are intelligent people. These are lawyers and doctors. They have no idea how they're being. I'm like, look at that fucking rating. Why can't they take that rating and just let the building know that you got to comply at some point within 10 years? Why do they have to post it? This isn't a fucking restaurant. They put it right by the mailboxes. It's the biggest scam ever.
Mark, someone told me that you go to C-rated restaurants.
Not all the time.
This interview's over.
It depends on the girl I'm dating at the time. What she deserves.
See if they give me a break on the price.
You give me an A-rated blowjob, we'll go to a B-rated restaurant right now. That being said, listen, Pat, man, you took the time out. You spent over an hour with us. We really, really appreciate it. Can we find? I know you have a Twitter account. Where is the Twitter? I wrote it somewhere here. Tell us about where can we find you?
Go Google Dead Guys in Suits. You'll find me.
Dead Guys in Suits.
Yeah, that's it's a blog. Right? I blog about guys getting bumped off. Pretty much every day or every couple days. I try to do every day, but sometimes it doesn't work out. But you know, on this day in 1929, so and so got bumped off. Like tomorrow is going to be a purple gang guy from Detroit from 1929.
How do we join this?
It's my blog, deadgangster.blogspot.com.
I'm writing it down. Dead gang, because we're gonna. I'll post this on deadgangster.blogspot.com.
If you Google dead guys in suits, you'll find it that way too.
The guys in suits.
That's another thing I find fascinating about those times, the pictures of the guys who got shot. There's something about the black and white photos and, you know, their hats and suits.
They had great hats.
Well, that's what I was earlier when we started about the clothing, the music.
Yeah.
When you're writing about that time, putting yourself in that place and what it felt like, what it smelled like. And when you say dead guys in suits, the fedoras, these are not only were they wearing suits, but they were wearing the best suits of the time.
Right. And the fedoras, the overcoats with velvet collars, just
and it's
designs.
It's funny that the same type of personality comes through, because the way you're fascinated about this time, I think I'm growing fascinated by the frontier, the West.
Uh-huh.
And one of the things that's depicted in the movie Tombstone is the colors in the outfits that the cowboys are wearing, everybody in town's wearing. And the way to tell who had the money and who was successful was by how you dressed.
Mm-hmm.
So although we depict the West with a lot of grays and browns, the reality is the people that were gambling in these towns, the people that were drinking in the saloons, a lot of them wore flamboyant colors, pinks, reds, purples, anything that could make them stick out. And they were very into fashion, and they were always, you know, who could design my clothes. They were very into jewelry, anything that you can spend your money on to show that you weren't a freaking loser like everybody else. You know what I'm saying?
Right. You're not wearing buckskin.
Yeah, it's consistent through the time.
Yeah.
The criminals, the gangsters, the outlaws, they always want to dress a little bit better than everybody else and show off.
Yeah, Al Capone showing up for court in a, you know, canary yellow suit on one day and then a green suit the next day, just as opposed to just a gray or a brown, you know. It's look at me. They wanted the attention. Look at me.
It's a funny.
I made it. I'm not that, you know, poor kid shining shoes on the Lower East Side anymore. Now I got a purple silk suit. I'm somebody.
That's amazing. Yeah, that's so
a good shot.
Yeah.
Just the way we are. Well, thanks for coming and stopping
by. Thanks for having me. It's a lot of fun.
Spending time with us. I'm a big fan. I'm going to check out your stuff. And for those of us who tuned in tonight, don't forget to check out Dead Guys in Suits. It's a blog that our guest, Pat Downey Jr., writes almost daily. He's got so many great books, Gangster City, History of New York, Underworld, Bad Seeds, Big Apple Bandits, and Hollywood on the Spot. I'm going to check them all out.
All righty. Thank you, guys. Had a lot of fun.
Thanks, Pat.
So take care.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Good night.